In 2012, I found myself trekking through the dense rainforests of the Congo Basin. My name is Gareth Muldoon, a seasoned wildlife photographer with a penchant for the unpredictable. I've spent over 2 decades capturing the raw beauty of nature, from the icy realms of Antarctica to the arid expanses of the Sahara. This time, I was on assignment to document the elusive okapi in its natural habitat, a task that thrilled me to my core. The air was thick with humidity, and every breath felt like inhaling warm soup. The cacophony of insects and distant calls of unseen creatures created a symphony that only the heart of Africa could compose. I set out early that morning, armed with my camera and a determination to get the perfect shot. The locals had warned me about venturing too deep, but I've always believed that the best photos lie just beyond the known paths. I hired a local guide named Kofi, a quiet man with eyes that seemed to hold secrets of the jungle. He spoke little English, and my Lingala was rudimentary at best, but we managed to communicate through gestures and shared glances. As we delved deeper into the forest, the canopy above grew denser, allowing only specks of sunlight to pierce through. "Okapi," Kofi whispered, pointing to a set of hoofprints in the damp soil. I nodded, excitement bubbling within me. We followed the tracks, moving as silently as possible. Hours passed, but there was no sign of the elusive creature. Instead, an eerie silence began to settle around us. The usual sounds of the jungle faded, replaced by an unsettling stillness. "Kofi, do you hear that?" I asked, my voice barely above a whisper. He looked around nervously. "No good. We go back." "Come on, we're so close," I urged. "Just a little further." He shook his head firmly. "No, bad place." Before I could argue further, a distant scream echoed through the trees, a sound so piercing it made the hairs on the back of my neck stand up. It wasn't an animalistic cry, it sounded human. "Did you hear that?" I asked. Kofi's face drained of color. "We leave now," he insisted. But my curiosity got the better of me. "Someone might be in trouble. We have to check it out." He grabbed my arm with surprising strength. "No, spirits of forest. Dangerous." I gently pulled away. "I'll be quick. Wait here if you want." Against his protests, I moved toward the direction of the scream. The foliage grew thicker and the path became treacherous. After about 20 minutes, I stumbled upon a small clearing. What I saw froze me in my tracks. In the middle of the clearing lay a group of people, at least 5 of them. Their bodies were contorted in unnatural angles, and deep gashes marred their flesh. The ground was stained dark with blood. Flies buzzed around the scene, adding to the macabre tableau. I felt a wave of nausea, but forced myself to approach. These people didn't look like locals. Their attire suggested they were tourists or researchers. Among them, I noticed a woman clutching a camera similar to mine. My heart pounded as I realized that they might have been on a similar mission. A rustling sound snapped me out of my daze. I turned abruptly, scanning the tree line. "Hello? Is anyone there?" I called out, my voice betraying a hint of fear. Silence. I took a deep breath and decided to document the scene. If nothing else, authorities needed to see this. As I raised my camera, a low chuckle echoed from somewhere behind me. It wasn't a joyful laugh, it was cold, mirthless. "Who's there?" I demanded, trying to keep my voice steady. No response. I backed away slowly, keeping my eyes on the surrounding trees. Just then, something darted between the trunks, a blur of movement that was too fast to be human. Panic surged through me. I turned and sprinted back the way I came, branches whipping against my face. "Kofi!" I shouted as I ran. "Kofi!" But when I reached the spot where I'd left him, he was gone. All that remained was his machete lying on the ground. My mind raced. Did he go back to the village? Was he taken? I picked up the machete, feeling slightly more secure with a weapon in hand. I tried to retrace our steps, but the jungle seemed different now, as if the paths had shifted. Every direction looked the same, and the canopy above blocked out any sense of time. "Stay calm," I muttered to myself. "You've gotten out of worse situations." But deep down, I knew this was different. There was an oppressive feeling in the air, a sense that I was being watched. I thought about a joke my old mentor used to say. In the jungle, you might be at the top of the food chain, until you're not. I pressed on, hacking away at the underbrush. After what felt like hours, I stumbled upon another clearing. In the center stood a massive termite mound, but something was off. Symbols were etched into its sides, intricate designs that didn't look natural. Curiosity battled with fear. I approached cautiously, examining the carvings. They resembled a mix of tribal art and something more arcane. As I circled the mound, I nearly tripped over a pile of bones. Human bones. A chilling realization settled in. This wasn't just a random tragedy. Something malevolent was at work here. A sudden snap of a twig made me spin around. Standing at the edge of the clearing was a creature unlike anything I'd ever seen. It stood upright like a human, but was covered in mottled, leathery skin. Its limbs were elongated, and its fingers ended in sharp claws. The face was the most disturbing, a grotesque fusion of human and bat-like features, with a snout and sharp teeth. My mind raced to make sense of it. It reminded me of a fruit bat, but grotesquely mutated and far too large. The creature tilted its head, studying me with small dark eyes. I gripped the machete tighter. "Easy now," I whispered, not sure if I was talking to it or myself. In a blur, it lunged forward. I swung the machete wildly, feeling it connect with something solid. The creature let out a shriek, a high-pitched sound that rattled my eardrums. It retreated a few steps, clutching its arm where I had struck. Not wasting a second, I turned and ran. The jungle was a maze, but adrenaline fueled my movements. Behind me, I could hear the creature crashing through the foliage, gaining ground. Up ahead, I saw a large fallen tree bridging a ravine. It was risky, but I had no choice. I scrambled up and began to cross, balancing carefully. Halfway across, the creature emerged from the trees, eyes locked onto me. "Come on, you oversized bat!" I yelled, trying to mask my terror with bravado. It started across the log with alarming speed. I reached the other side and, without thinking, shoved the log with all my might. The makeshift bridge shifted, and with a creak, it tumbled into the ravine below, taking the creature with it. I peered over the edge. The creature lay motionless on the rocky bottom. Relief washed over me, but it was short-lived. A movement caught my eye. It was starting to stir. "Unbelievable," I muttered. I needed to get out of there. I pushed onward, and finally the jungle began to thin. I recognized a landmark, a peculiar tree that split into three trunks. I was close to the village. Bursting through the last of the trees, I stumbled into the clearing where the villagers went about their daily routines. They looked up in surprise as I collapsed to my knees, gasping for breath.
"Help! There's something out there!" I shouted.
The villagers exchanged worried glances. An elder approached me.
"You saw the Mokele Mbembe," he said solemnly. I shook my head. "No, this wasn't a dinosaur. It was... I don't know what it was."
He placed a hand on my shoulder. "Some things are not meant to be found." Just then, a scream erupted from the other side of the village. We turned to see chaos unfolding. The creature had made its way into the village, attacking indiscriminately. Women and children scattered, and the men grabbed whatever they could find to defend themselves. I watched in horror as it swiped at a young man, claws ripping through flesh with ease. Without thinking, I grabbed a spear leaning against a hut and charged.
"Over here!"
I yelled. The creature turned its attention to me. Time seemed to slow down as it charged forward. At the last second, I sidestepped and thrust the spear into its side. It let out another ear-piercing shriek, but didn't go down. Villagers joined in, throwing spears and rocks. The creature was outnumbered but fought viciously. It grabbed one of the men, sinking its teeth into his neck. Blood sprayed as the man fell limp. An idea flashed in my mind.
"Fire! We need fire!"
Several villagers understood. They hurried to grab torches from the huts. I picked one up and waved it at the creature. It recoiled slightly, unsure.
"Yeah, not a fan of fire, are you?" I taunted.
We formed a circle around it, closing in with the torches. The creature thrashed, trying to find an escape. Finally, cornered against a large hut, it snarled defensively.
"Now!"
I shouted. Together we lunged forward, pressing the torches against its skin. Flames caught on its leathery hide.
The creature let out a final agonized scream as it succumbed to the fire, collapsing in a heap. Silence settled over the village, broken only by the crackling of flames. The villagers stared at the smoldering remains, a mix of fear and relief etched on their faces. The elder approached me once more. "You have brought great danger upon us," he said gravely. "I was just trying to help," I replied defensively. He nodded slowly. "And help you did. But now we must perform the rites to cleanse this place." I didn't fully understand, but I respected their customs. As night fell, the villagers began a ceremonial dance around the creature's ashes, chanting in a language I couldn't comprehend. Feeling out of place, I retreated to my hut. Exhaustion hit me like a freight train. I laid down, my mind racing with the day's events. Sleep was elusive. At dawn, I decided it was time to leave. I packed my belongings, ensuring my camera and memory cards were secure. As I made my way through the village, the elder stopped me. "Take care, Gareth Muldoon," he said, his eyes reflecting a wisdom beyond my understanding. "I will," I replied. "Thank you for everything." He handed me a small amulet. "For protection. The jungle holds many secrets." I accepted it gratefully and began my journey back to civilization. The path was long, but the thought of putting distance between myself and that cursed place propelled me forward. A week later, I was back in London, the bustling city life a stark contrast to the wilds I'd left behind. I met with my editor, a gruff man named Lionel Worthington, who was eager to see my work. "So, did you get the shots?" he asked, not looking up from his desk. "Oh, I got something all right," I replied, handing over my camera. He scrolled through the images, his expression shifting from boredom to intrigue to shock. "What in the world is this?" "That's what I'd like to know," I said. He leaned back, processing what he'd seen. "You realize what this could mean? This is groundbreaking." "Or dangerous," I cautioned. He scoffed. "Don't be so dramatic. This is the scoop of the century." Just then, his office door swung open. Two men in suits walked in, their faces void of emotion. "Can we help you?" Lionel asked irritably. One of the men flashed a badge. "I'm Agent Thompson, and this is Agent Ramirez. We're with the government." I raised an eyebrow. "Since when does the government care about wildlife photography?" They ignored my question. "Mr. Muldoon, we'd like you to come with us." Lionel stood up. "Now wait a minute." Before he could finish, Agent Ramirez pulled out a document. "This is a matter of national security." I felt a knot form in my stomach. "What's this about?" Agent Thompson looked at me sternly. "It's about what you encountered in the Congo." Lionel's eyes darted between us. "Care to explain?" "All information regarding this matter is classified," Agent Ramirez stated flatly. They escorted me out of the building and into an unmarked car. As we drove away, I glanced back at Lionel's bewildered face peering through his office window. In the car, the agents remained silent. I mustered the courage to speak. "Look, I don't know what you think I saw, but—" Agent Thompson cut me off. "We know exactly what you saw, and it's imperative that it remains confidential." "Are you kidding me? People died out there. The world deserves to know what's happening." Agent Ramirez turned to face me. "Disclosing this information would cause widespread panic. Trust us when we say it's better this way." I clenched my fists. "So what happens now? Are you going to make me disappear too?" Agent Thompson smirked. "Nothing so dramatic. We just need you to sign a non-disclosure agreement. Standard procedure." They pulled into a secure facility on the outskirts of the city. Inside, I was led to a sterile room where a stack of documents awaited. I skimmed through the legal jargon. It was extensive. "This is absurd," I protested. "You can't just silence me." Agent Ramirez sighed. "We can, and we will. Or you can face charges of treason." I weighed my options. As much as I wanted to expose the truth, I realized I was up against forces far beyond my control. Reluctantly, I signed the papers. "Wise choice," Agent Thompson remarked, collecting the documents. They returned my camera but informed me that all data related to the incident had been confiscated. "You're free to go," Agent Ramirez said. As I exited the building, a thought struck me. Reaching into my pocket, I pulled out the amulet the elder had given me. Tucked behind it was a small memory card. I must have slipped it there absentmindedly. A subtle grin formed on my face. Maybe all wasn't lost. Weeks later, I sat in a dimly lit pub, contemplating my next move. The world was none the wiser about the horrors lurking in the Congo, and perhaps that was for the best. But I couldn't shake the feeling that this was just the tip of the iceberg. A bartender approached. Another round? Sure, why not? I replied. He poured me a drink. You look like a man with stories to tell. I chuckled. You have no idea. He leaned in. Well, we've got time. Hit me with your best shot. I took a sip of the amber liquid. Did I ever tell you about the time I outran a bat-faced creature in the middle of the Congo? He raised an eyebrow. Can't say that you have. Well, I said, a mischievous glint in my eye. It's a tale that's bound to drive you batty. He groaned. That's terrible. I laughed. Yeah, but it gets worse. As I launched into a sanitized version of my story, I couldn't help but think about the absurdity of it all. Life has a way of throwing curveballs, and sometimes the best you can do is swing and hope for a hit. Little did I know, across the world in a dimly lit room, Agents Thompson and Ramirez were monitoring a new anomaly, a disturbance that suggested the creature wasn't as unique as they thought. But that, as they say, is a story for another time. I was crouched in the brush, camera poised and ready, waiting for a rare red-throated loon to emerge from the still waters of Healy Lake in Alaska. The year was 1986, and the landscape was untouched, just the way I liked it. My name's Travis Holcomb, and I've spent the better part of 2 decades crawling through mud, scaling cliffs, and braving the elements to get the perfect shot for wildlife magazines. People think it's glamorous, but let me tell you, wading waist-deep in icy water or dodging elk during mating season will make you reconsider your career choices. This job was supposed to be a quiet one, just me, a rented cabin near the lake and the wilderness. The nearest town, Delta Junction, was a good 40 minutes away. My only neighbor was a retired oil worker named Silas McCreary, who lived a mile down the dirt road and kept mostly to himself. We'd exchanged a few pleasantries when I arrived. He seemed like a decent enough guy, though his jittery demeanor was hard to ignore. He'd warned me about the things that come out at night, but I chalked it up to cabin fever and too much whiskey. It was mid-afternoon when I noticed the forest had gone eerily silent. No birds, no rustling leaves, just the faint hum of wind through the pines. I glanced at my watch. The loon was overdue. As I scanned the shoreline through my telephoto lens, I spotted something moving between the trees. At first I thought it was a bear, but the shape was all wrong. Too tall, too lean, and moving in a way that felt unnervingly deliberate. It disappeared into the forest before I could get a clear look. That was my first mistake, staying to investigate instead of heading back to the cabin. I packed up my gear and trekked toward where I'd seen the figure. The undergrowth was thick, but I managed to follow a trail of broken branches and deep impressions in the soft earth. Whatever had made them was heavy, with a stride far longer than any man's. I couldn't shake the feeling that I wasn't alone. As I pushed deeper into the woods, I found something that made me stop cold. A pile of carcasses. Deer, rabbits, and even a black bear cub, all mauled beyond recognition and arranged in a circle. The stench was overpowering, and the ground was slick with blood. Flies buzzed in a chaotic frenzy, but it was the gnawed bones and jagged bite marks that made my stomach churn. I'd seen wolf kills before, but this was something else entirely. I backed away, every instinct screaming at me to leave. The snap of a branch behind me sent adrenaline surging through my veins. I spun around, but nothing was there. The forest was too quiet, like it was holding its breath. That's when I saw it again, further down the trail. A silhouette too tall to be human, hunched and covered in matted fur. Its head was tilted unnaturally, as if it was studying me. I did what any sane person would do. I ran. My boots pounded the earth as I tore through the forest, branches slapping my face and catching on my jacket. I didn't look back, When I burst into the clearing near my cabin, I threw the door open and slammed it behind me, bolting the latch. My heart was hammering in my chest as I grabbed my hunting knife, a relic from my younger days, and backed into the corner of the room. Hours passed, but nothing happened. I started to convince myself I'd imagined the whole thing when a thud against the cabin wall made me jump. It was followed by another, then a slow, deliberate scraping sound, like claws dragging across the wood. My breath hitched as I realized it wasn't trying to break in, it was testing me. The noises stopped abruptly, and I thought for one brief, foolish moment that it had gone. That's when I heard Silas screaming. The sound was gut-wrenching, primal, and it was coming from his cabin down the road. I hesitated, my gut telling me to stay put, but my legs had other plans. Knife in hand, I bolted out the door and into the darkness. The air was frigid, each breath stabbing my lungs as I ran toward the sound. Silas's cabin came into view, and the sight made me skid to a halt. The door was hanging off its hinges, and the inside was illuminated by the flickering glow of an overturned lantern. Blood smeared the walls, and the floor was littered with broken furniture. I called out for Silas, but the only response was a low, gurgling moan. I found him crumpled in the corner, his chest a mess of shredded flesh. He was alive, barely, but his wide, glassy stare told me he knew he wouldn't be for long. His trembling hand gripped my wrist as he whispered, "Don't look up." The words barely registered before I heard the creak of floorboards above me. The ceiling groaned as something massive shifted its weight. I froze, my grip tightening on the knife. Whatever was up there had to weigh at least a few hundred pounds. I glanced at Silas, but his head had slumped to the side. He was gone. A sudden crash sent splinters raining down as the creature leapt from the loft. It landed in the center of the room, and for the first time, I saw it clearly. It was at least 7 feet tall, with long, sinewy limbs and skin that looked like it had been flayed and stitched back together. Its head was narrow, like a wolf's, but its snout was shorter, more like a hyena's. Thick ropes of saliva dripped from jagged teeth, and its breath reeked of decay. It didn't roar or snarl, it just stared at me with a chilling intelligence that made my blood run cold. My muscles tensed as it crouched, ready to pounce. When it lunged, I dove to the side, the knife in my hand slashing wildly. The blade caught its shoulder, and a howl of pain erupted from its throat. Black, tar-like blood sprayed across the room. The creature recoiled, but only for a moment. It charged again, swiping with claws that ripped through my jacket and grazed my ribs. The pain was blinding, but adrenaline kept me moving. I grabbed the overturned lantern and smashed it against its chest, flames erupting and spreading across its fur. It let out a keening shriek and thrashed wildly, knocking over a table and sending debris flying. I didn't wait to see what happened next. I bolted out the door and sprinted back toward my cabin. The forest blurred around me as the creature's screams echoed in the distance. When I reached the cabin, I grabbed my camera bag, stuffed in the few essentials I could carry, and headed for my truck. The drive to Delta Junction was a blur. I didn't stop, didn't look back, didn't even think until I was sitting in the parking lot of the town's tiny sheriff's office. When I told them what had happened, they didn't believe me. A search party found Silas's cabin burned to the ground, the remains unrecognizable. They ruled it a bear attack, despite the lack of tracks or fur samples to support the claim. I left Alaska the next day and never looked back. To this day, I wonder what kind of animal could be so calculating, so cruel. But one thing's for sure, whatever it wasn't alone. It was 1986, and I'd been trudging along as a wildlife photographer for nearly a decade, making a living by crawling through thickets and wading into bogs to get the perfect shot of a bird no one had ever heard of, or a fox most people assumed was just a myth. My name's Elijah Marks, and back then I thought I'd seen just about everything. I've been charged by territorial elk, nearly drowned in a swamp trying to photograph a rare heron, and been bitten by more mosquitoes than I care to count. But nothing, and I mean nothing, prepared me for what happened in the forests of Michigan's Upper Peninsula that fall. I was chasing the rumor of a creature locals called the Hollow Beast. Now, I've heard all the cryptid stories over the years. Bigfoot, Chupacabra, Mothman. They're great for tourism, but rarely more than a good yarn spun by someone too deep into their whiskey. Still, I'd been hired by a conservation group to document anything unusual, and the hollow beast fit the bill. Locals said it was part bear, part wolf, and part something else no one could quite put their finger on. They claimed it had hollowed out trees where it nested, and that it left behind carcasses of animals it had drained completely dry. A fanciful tale, I thought, but a paid gig is a paid gig. So, armed with my camera, some trail mix, and a borrowed rifle I barely knew how to use, I set out into the dense woods near Grand Marais. The forest there is dense, a tapestry of pine and birch with the kind of eerie quiet you only find far away from civilization. Even the air feels heavier, like the trees are conspiring to hold you in. I had a guide, a wiry man named Marlin Teague who looked like he'd been carved out of the woods themselves. Marlin had the kind of face you only see in oil paintings of grizzled old explorers with a thick beard and eyes that didn't miss much. Marlin wasn't much for conversation, but he did have a knack for telling off-color jokes. He broke the silence that morning by saying, "You know why the hollow beast hasn't been caught? Same reason my ex-wife's alimony checks bounce. It's slippery as hell and twice as mean." I chuckled politely, but Marlin didn't laugh at his own joke, which I took as a bad sign. We trekked deep into the woods, following a game trail littered with odd signs, scratch marks on trees that were too high for any bear, piles of scat with fragments of bone in them, and once a deer carcass so mangled that Marlin muttered, "Hell, even wolves wouldn't waste that much meat." He touched the carcass with the toe of his boot, shook his head, and said nothing more. By late afternoon, we came across what looked like a hunting blind built into the side of a hill. Marlin said it wasn't his, but it looked recent. The wood was fresh cut, and there were old beer cans and a cigarette butt nearby. Someone had been there recently, but there was no sign of them now. We decided to set up camp nearby. The blind offered some shelter, and I figured I could mount a small camera trap on the structure to see if anything came by in the night. As darkness fell, the forest came alive with sounds, chirping insects, distant hoots of owls, and the occasional rustle of something large moving through the underbrush. Marlin had a little camp stove, and we made coffee as we settled in. He told another joke, this one about a raccoon stealing a wallet, but I barely heard him. My focus was on the woods around us. Then the forest went silent. If you've spent time in the wild, you know how unnatural that is. It's not just the absence of sound, it's the presence of something else, something oppressive that makes your skin crawl. Marlin froze mid-sentence, his hand hovering over the stove. I whispered, asking him if he'd heard something. He didn't answer. A sharp crack echoed from the woods to our east, followed by a low, rumbling noise that didn't quite register as anything natural. It was like the sound of a tree falling, but stretched out and resonant, almost metallic. Marlin grabbed his rifle and muttered under his breath, something that sounded like a prayer. We stayed like that for what felt like hours, though it was probably just minutes. The noise came again, closer this time. I clutched my camera, its weight suddenly inadequate, and pointed it toward the sound. My heart hammered in my chest as I clicked the shutter blindly, hoping to capture whatever was out there. And then we saw it. It emerged from the shadows, moving with a jerky, unnatural gait. At first, I thought it was a bear, but its proportions were all wrong. Its torso was elongated, almost serpentine, and its legs bent backward like a bird's. Patches of its fur were missing, revealing raw, grayish skin underneath. Its face was the worst part, a grotesque blend of canine and something reptilian, with a gaping maw that seemed too wide for its head. Marlin raised his rifle, but the creature moved faster than anything that size should have been able to. It darted toward him in a blur, and before he could get a shot off, it was on him. The sound it made was unlike anything I'd heard, wet and guttural, like 1,000 pounds of flesh tearing apart. Marlin screamed, his voice cutting through the night like a blade, and I froze. I should have run or helped or done something, but my legs wouldn't move. The creature ripped into him, tearing through his torso as if he were made of paper. Blood sprayed across the blind, splattering my camera and face. I wanted to vomit, but I couldn't even do that. Somewhere in the chaos, my survival instincts kicked in. I turned and bolted into the woods, my camera swinging wildly around my neck. The forest was a maze of shadows and branches, and I tripped more than once, the weight of Marlin's death chasing me with every step. Behind me, the sounds of tearing and snarling subsided, replaced by the rapid thuds of heavy footsteps. It was coming after me. I don't remember how long I ran, but I eventually stumbled into a clearing where an old abandoned logging cabin stood. The roof was caved in, and the windows were shattered, but it was shelter. I scrambled inside and slammed what was left of the door behind me. I could hear the creature outside, circling the cabin. Its footsteps were deliberate, almost taunting. I pressed myself against the far wall, clutching a rusted fire poker I'd found inside, and waited. The thing rammed the door once, then twice, each hit shaking the flimsy structure. I braced myself for it to burst through, but then the noise stopped. I strained to hear, but all I caught was silence again. The same oppressive, heavy silence from before. When dawn broke, I dared to step outside. There was no sign of the creature, but the forest floor was torn up with deep gouges, and Marlin's rifle lay in the dirt, bent in half like a cheap toy. I stumbled back to civilization, my clothes torn and caked with blood. The locals didn't ask too many questions, but their expressions told me they knew. When I mentioned Marlin's name, one old man shook his head and said, "He should have known better. I never found out what that thing was, but I don't need to. Whatever it wasn't natural, and it wasn't meant to be found." My name is Victor Hargrove, and this happened to me on June 15, 1995, in the dense forests of the Pacific Northwest. I was a wildlife photographer, chasing the elusive shots that would make my career. The forest was my second home, a place where I felt more at ease among the trees than in any city. I had set out early that morning, the mist still clinging to the underbrush. My goal was to capture images of a rare species of owl rumored to inhabit this part of the woods. Equipped with my camera, a notebook, and enough supplies for a day's trek, I felt prepared for whatever nature had in store. About an hour into my hike, I met a park ranger named Elena Marsh. She was mapping the area for a new trail and warned me about unexplained disappearances in the region. "Three hikers have gone missing this month," she said, her eyes scanning the treetops. "Stay alert out here." I thanked her for the caution, but didn't think much of it. People got lost in these woods all the time. It was easy to stray off the path. I continued deeper into the forest, the canopy above thickening and the sounds of wildlife growing louder. Around midday, I reached a clearing where I decided to rest. As I ate a sandwich, I noticed unusual markings on the trees, deep scratches that seemed too large for any known animal in the area. I took photographs of them, intrigued by their size and the force it must have taken to make them. Continuing on, the forest grew eerily quiet. The usual sounds of birds and insects faded until all I could hear was the crunch of leaves under my boots. Then, a distant scream echoed through the trees. It was cut off abruptly, sending a chill down my spine. I headed toward the source of the sound, moving cautiously. After several minutes, I stumbled upon a campsite. Tents were torn apart, supplies scattered, and there was blood. A lot of it. I found no bodies, but the scene was unmistakably violent. Claw marks similar to those I'd seen earlier marred the surrounding trees. As I surveyed the destruction, I heard rustling behind me. Turning quickly, I saw Elena emerging from the bushes, her face pale. "What happened here?" she whispered. "I don't know," I replied, "but whatever did this is still nearby." We decided to stick together and radioed for backup, but our devices malfunctioned. Static filled the channels, rendering them useless. With dusk approaching, we agreed to head back to the ranger station. As we retraced our steps, the forest seemed to close in around us. Shadows stretched longer and the air grew thick. Suddenly, a figure darted between the trees ahead, a large, hulking shape moving with unnatural speed. "Did you see that?" Elena asked, her voice barely audible. "Yes," I said, gripping my camera like a weapon. "We need to keep moving." We picked up the pace, but the creature began to stalk us, its movements parallel to our own. It stayed just out of clear sight, but glimpses revealed matted fur and a silhouette larger than a bear. Without warning, it charged. The beast burst from the underbrush, revealing itself fully. It stood on four legs like a wolf, but was the size of a moose. Its body was covered in thick, dark fur, and its jaws were lined with teeth that seemed too numerous and jagged to belong to any known animal. Elena drew a flare gun from her belt and fired. The flare struck the creature's shoulder, causing it to recoil with a snarl. I grabbed a fallen branch and swung as it lunged at me, striking its snout. The impact barely fazed it. The creature swiped at Elena, its claws tearing into her arm. She cried out and fell back. I snapped a series of photos, hoping the flash would deter it. Surprisingly, the light did cause it to hesitate.
"Run!"
I shouted, pulling Elena to her feet. We sprinted through the forest, the creature in pursuit. Branches whipped our faces, and the uneven ground threatened to trip us with every step. Ahead, I saw the glimmer of a river.
"Head for the water!" I yelled.
Reaching the riverbank, we scrambled across slippery rocks. The creature hesitated at the edge before leaping after us. In the chaos, Elena slipped and fell into the water, the current pulling her downstream.
"Elena!"
I called out, but there was no time. The beast was upon me. With no options left, I pulled out my pocket knife. As it lunged, I thrust the blade into its neck. It let out a horrifying sound and snapped at me, its teeth grazing my shoulder. I stabbed again, this time aiming for what I hoped was a vital spot. The creature staggered, blood pouring from its wounds. Seizing the moment, I pushed it, and it toppled into the river. The swift current swept it away, its massive form disappearing around a bend. Breathing heavily, I looked around. Elena was nowhere in sight. I followed the riverbank and found her clinging to a rock downstream. I helped her up. She was injured but alive. We made it back to the ranger station just as night fell. A search party was organized, and they recovered the bodies of the missing hikers near the campsite I'd found. The authorities examined my photographs and took statements from both of us. The creature's body was later discovered downstream, confirming our account. Scientists were baffled, unable to classify it with any known species. The forest was temporarily closed off for investigation. In the end, the park resumed operations and life moved on. My name is Thaddeus Crowley, and on October 14, 1995, I found myself trekking through the dense woods of the Allegheny National Forest in Pennsylvania, chasing the perfect shot for a wildlife photography series I was working on. Ever since I was a kid growing up in a small town nearby, I'd been fascinated by the secrets these woods held. That morning, the mist hung low, wrapping around the towering oaks and maples like a ghostly shroud. I had my camera slung over my shoulder and a backpack filled with supplies. My goal was to capture the elusive eastern cougar, rumored to have been extinct in these parts for decades, but recently spotted by a few locals. As I made my way deeper into the forest, I came across an old logging trail. The path was overgrown, but it offered a clearer route through the thick underbrush. After an hour of hiking, I noticed the forest had gone unnaturally quiet. No birds chirping, no rustling leaves, just an eerie silence that made the hairs on the back of my neck stand up. I shrugged it off, attributing it to my overactive imagination. Continuing along the trail, I spotted fresh tracks in the mud. They were large, larger than any cougar print I'd ever seen. Kneeling down, I snapped a photo of the imprint. "Maybe it's a black bear," I muttered to myself. A snapping twig caused me to whip around. "Who's there?" I called out. No response. I scanned the trees but saw nothing unusual. Deciding to move on, I quickened my pace. The feeling of being watched was growing stronger. About midday, I reached a small clearing where the remains of an old cabin stood. Curious, I approached it. The door was hanging off its hinges and the wood was rotten. Inside, I found tattered clothes scattered across the floor and what looked like claw marks etched into the walls.
"That's not unsettling at all," I whispered.
Just then, I heard footsteps outside. Peering through a gap in the wall, I saw a figure moving between the trees.
"Hello?"
I called out, stepping back into the sunlight. A man emerged, a park ranger by the looks of his uniform.
"Didn't mean to startle you," he said with a grin. "Name's Vernon Hayes. What brings you out here?"
"Thaddeus Crowley," I replied, extending a hand.
I'm a wildlife photographer looking for the eastern cougar. He chuckled. Cougars, huh? Haven't seen those around here in years. Well, someone has to document if they're making a comeback. Be careful out here, he warned. These woods aren't as safe as they used to be. Before I could ask what he meant, he tipped his hat and disappeared back into the trees. Odd guy, I thought, but didn't dwell on it. I decided to set up a few motion-activated cameras around the clearing, hoping to catch something overnight. As dusk approached, I started making my way back to a campsite I'd passed earlier. The forest was getting darker, and the canopy above blocked out most of the remaining light. That's when I heard a scream, a blood-curdling cry that echoed through the trees. It sounded human. Without thinking, I ran toward the source. After a few minutes, I stumbled upon a gruesome scene. Another park ranger lay on the ground, his body torn apart. Deep gashes crisscrossed his torso, and his eyes stared lifelessly into the sky. My stomach churned. I fumbled for the radio clip to his belt. Hello? Can anyone hear me? There's been an attack. Static. A low rumbling noise came from behind me. Turning slowly, I caught sight of something moving between the trees. It was massive, walking on all fours. Its body was covered in matted fur, and it had the muscular build of a wolf, but much larger, easily the size of a grizzly bear. I backed away slowly, but a branch snapped under my foot. The creature's head snapped in my direction. Its face resembled that of a hyena, with powerful jaws and sharp teeth that glinted even in the low light. Without warning, it charged. I bolted, adrenaline surging through me. The creature was fast, crashing through the underbrush with terrifying speed. I could hear it gaining on me. Up ahead, I saw the faint glow of a fire. It was Vernon's campsite. Help! I shouted at the top of my lungs. Vernon emerged from his tent, rifle in hand. His eyes widened as he saw the beast behind me. Get down! He yelled. I dove to the ground as a shot rang out. The bullet struck the creature in the shoulder, causing it to veer off course and slam into a tree. It shook off the impact and turned to face us again. That didn't stop it, I shouted. Inside the cabin, Vernon ordered. We sprinted to a nearby hunting cabin, barricading the door behind us. The creature slammed against the walls, snarling and clawing. Wood splintered as its claws tore through the exterior. Is that thing a bear? I asked, panting. Never seen a bear like that, Vernon replied, loading another round into his rifle. The creature began ramming the door with more force. We can't stay here, I said. It'll tear this place apart. There's a trap door under the rug, Vernon said. Leads to a root cellar. Go. We pulled back the rug and lifted the hatch. I climbed down the ladder first, landing on the dirt floor below. Vernon followed, closing the hatch just as the door above burst open. In the darkness, we could hear the creature stomping around upstairs, knocking over furniture and growling in frustration. I felt around and found an old oil lamp. With trembling hands, I lit it, casting a dim glow around the cellar. What's that? I asked, pointing to a pile of bones in the corner. Vernon's face paled. Those weren't here before. Among the bones were torn pieces of clothing, park ranger uniforms and hiking gear. How many people have gone missing out here? I whispered. Too many, he replied. We need to end this. He pulled out a flare gun from his pack. This might be our only chance. The noises upstairs ceased. Then the hatch above us started to creak. Claws ripped through the wood, and one massive limb broke through, groping blindly. Now! Vernon shouted, firing the flare gun. The flare hit the creature square in the chest, igniting its fur. It let out a horrifying screech and thrashed violently. Go! Vernon pushed me toward a small tunnel at the back of the cellar. We crawled through the tight space, the heat from the fire growing intense behind us. Emerging outside, we ran as the cabin above collapsed in flames. But the creature wasn't done. Burning and enraged, it burst from the wreckage, eyes fixed on us. Vernon raised his rifle and fired repeatedly, each shot hitting the beast but not stopping it. Desperate, I grabbed a sharp piece of metal from the ground, part of the cabin's roofing. As the creature lunged at Vernon, I drove the metal into its side with all my might. It let out a final ear-splitting howl before collapsing. We stood there, catching our breath, watching as the flames consumed its massive body. Is it... dead? I asked. Vernon nodded. Looks like it. The morning light began to filter through the trees. The remains of the creature lay still, the fire dying down. Authorities arrived soon after, alerted by the smoke and the earlier radio distress call. They surveyed the scene, recovering the bodies of the fallen rangers and examining the creature's carcass. As we gave our statements, the disbelief was clear on their faces, but the evidence was undeniable. Vernon and I parted ways after that. The forest was closed off, investigations were launched, and the story made headlines for weeks. My name is Elias Morton, and this happened to me on June 12, 1998, in the depths of the Blackwood National Forest. I'd been a wildlife photographer for over a decade, chasing the elusive and capturing the magnificent. That summer, the forest was my canvas, and I was eager to document the nesting habits of a rare species of hawk. I arrived at the ranger station early in the morning to meet with my old friend, Ranger Lucas Hayes. Lucas was a tall man with a sharp wit and a deeper love for the woods than anyone I knew. We shared a cup of coffee as he handed me a map marked with trails less traveled. "Stick to these paths, Eli," he said. "There have been reports of missing hikers lately. Probably nothing, but better safe than sorry." "Always cautious, aren't you?" I grinned, tucking the map into my backpack. "Just watch yourself out there," he replied, his eyes serious. I set off into the forest, the morning sun filtering through the canopy. The air was crisp, filled with the scent of pine and earth. My equipment weighed heavy on my back, but the thrill of the unknown pushed me forward. I planned to reach a clearing by noon, where the hawks were known to soar. As I trekked deeper, the sounds of civilization faded until only the whispers of leaves and the distant call of birds remained. Around mid-morning, I came across a small campsite. Two tents stood pitched, but there was no sign of the campers. A smoldering fire suggested they'd left in a hurry. "Hello?" I called out, but only the forest answered. Curiosity nudged me to look around. Near one of the tents, I spotted a backpack with a name tag: Amelia Rhodes. Inside were clothes, a wallet, and a journal. It wasn't like hikers to leave essentials behind. A chill ran down my spine, but I shrugged it off. "People get careless," I told myself. I decided to press on, making a mental note to inform Lucas on my return. By noon, I reached the clearing. The sky was vast, and the hawks danced upon the thermals. I set up my camera, focusing the lens to capture their grace. Hours slipped by unnoticed as I lost myself in work. The daylight began to wane, and I prepared to head back. Packing my gear, I felt an odd stillness settle over the area. The usual forest sounds had hushed. No rustling of small creatures, no bird songs, just silence. I started down the trail when a rustle caught my attention. Probably a deer, I thought. But then I saw it, a massive silhouette moving between the trees. It moved low to the ground, stalking. I froze, heart pounding. The creature emerged briefly into a shaft of light. It was unlike anything I'd ever seen, built like a wolf but the size of a bear, with coarse, matted fur and a powerful build. Its limbs were muscular, ending in claws that dug into the earth with each step. I reached slowly for my camera, snapping a quick shot. The click alerted the beast. Its head snapped up, and though I couldn't see its eyes, I knew it was looking straight at me. Instinct took over. I bolted down the path, branches whipping against my face. Behind me, heavy footsteps thundered, closing in. My mind raced. What was this thing? How could it move so fast? I veered off the trail, ducking behind a fallen log. The footsteps halted. I held my breath, gripping a thick branch as a feeble weapon. The creature sniffed the air, its breaths heavy. It prowled around the log, and I could feel the vibrations of its movement. Gathering courage, I waited until it was close, then swung the branch with all my might. The wood connected with a sickening thud against its skull. The beast staggered but didn't fall. It turned toward me, and in that moment, sheer determination kicked in. I ran again, adrenaline fueling my legs. Ahead, I spotted a narrow ravine. With no time to think, I leaped across, barely catching the other side. The creature skidded to a halt at the edge, hesitating. Seizing the moment, I scrambled up a rocky incline. The terrain was steep and my muscles screamed in protest. Reaching the top, I glanced back. The beast was gone. Relief washed over me, but it was short-lived. A blood-curdling scream echoed from somewhere deeper in the forest. It sounded human. Against my better judgment, I moved toward the sound. Pushing through dense underbrush, I emerged into another clearing. The scene before me was horrifying. Ranger Lucas lay on the ground, claw marks tearing through his uniform. Beside him was another ranger, whom I recognized as Dana Lopez. She was trying to staunch the bleeding with trembling hands.
"Eli, help us!" she shouted.
I rushed over, dropping to my knees. Lucas's face was pale, his breath shallow.
"What happened?"
I demanded.
"That thing," Dana stammered. "It came out of nowhere, took the others. We tried to fight it off."
"Others?" I asked.
"Two hikers went missing. We were searching when it attacked."
Lucas's eyes fluttered open.
"Eli, you need to get out. Warn them."
"Save your strength," I urged. A low sound rumbled nearby. The creature was close.
"We have to move," I said. "Can you walk?"
Dana helped Lucas to his feet. We started toward the ranger station, half carrying him. The forest seemed to close in around us, every shadow a threat. Suddenly, the beast burst from the foliage, blocking our path. Up close, it was even more terrifying. Scarred hide, powerful jaws, and an uncanny intelligence in its movements. Without thinking, I pulled a flare gun from Lucas's belt. Aiming at the creature, I fired. The flare struck its shoulder, igniting its fur. It let out a horrific sound, thrashing as flames licked its body.
"Now, go!"
I shouted. We stumbled forward as the beast writhed behind us. The station was still a mile away. Lucas was fading fast, and Dana was struggling to keep up. The sound of cracking branches signaled that the creature was in pursuit once more, despite its injury. Desperation fueled us. In the distance, I saw the glint of metal, the station's radio tower.
"Almost there!"
I yelled. We burst into the clearing where the station stood. I slammed the door behind us, bolting it shut. Dana grabbed the radio, calling for backup. The walls shook as the beast rammed against the building. Wood splintered, and I knew the door wouldn't hold.
"Arm yourselves,"
I ordered. We scattered, finding anything that could be used as a weapon. I grabbed a hunting rifle mounted on the wall, checking the chamber. 2 bullets. The door gave way, and the creature lunged inside. I fired once, hitting its leg. It stumbled but kept coming. Dana threw a chair, distracting it for a split second. I took aim again, this time steadying myself. As the beast leaped toward me, I pulled the trigger. The bullet struck its head and it collapsed mere feet away. Silence filled the room, broken only by our ragged breaths. Dana checked Lucas's pulse and looked up grimly. He was gone. I looked at the fallen creature. Its massive form lay still, the monstrous features undeniable. Soon the sound of sirens approached. Backup arrived, and they entered cautiously, weapons drawn.
"It's over,"
I said. They secured the area, eyes widening at the sight of the beast. No one could explain what it was, but there was no denying its existence. Outside, the first light of dawn began to break through the trees. My name is Aaron Wilder, and this happened to me on June 12, 1998, in the depths of Redwood National Park. I'd been a wildlife photographer for years, always chasing that perfect shot. You know, the one that makes all the early mornings and mosquito bites worth it. I was out there alone, which wasn't unusual for me. Solitude kind of comes with the job. I had just gotten a new camera lens and was eager to test it out. The morning air was crisp, the kind that wakes you up better than any coffee could. Sunlight filtered through the canopy, casting a mosaic of light and shadow on the forest floor. I felt good, optimistic even. Maybe today I'd capture something extraordinary. As I made my way deeper into the woods, I came across a ranger named Felix Hartman. We'd crossed paths a few times before. Felix was a tall guy with a thick beard and a dry sense of humor. He warned me about some strange reports, campers missing, that sort of thing. I shrugged it off. People got lost all the time out here.
"Just keep your wits about you, Aaron," he said, adjusting his hat.
"Always do," I replied with a grin. We parted ways and I ventured further into the wilderness. Hours passed as I snapped photos of deer, squirrels, and an elusive fox that darted away before I could focus. The day was turning out to be productive. Around midday, I stumbled upon an area I'd never seen before, a clearing with a small pond reflecting the sky like a mirror. It was picturesque, almost too perfect. I set up my tripod, eager to capture the scene. That's when I noticed something odd. The usual forest sounds had faded. No birds chirping, no rustling leaves, just silence. It was as if the whole place was holding its breath. A chill ran down my spine, but I brushed it off. Probably just my imagination playing tricks. I heard a rustling behind me. Turning around, I saw a man emerging from the trees. He was dressed in tattered clothes, dirty and disheveled. His eyes, well, they had a wild look to them. "Can I help you?" I asked, trying to sound casual. He didn't reply. Instead, he tilted his head, studying me like I was some kind of specimen. Unease began to creep in. "Are you lost?" I tried again. Still nothing. Then, without warning, he lunged at me with a knife. I barely dodged, stumbling backward and tripping over a root. Adrenaline surged through me as I scrambled to my feet. "What the hell's your problem?" I shouted. He came at me again, blade glinting in the dappled sunlight. I grabbed my tripod and swung it hard, catching him across the arm. He let out a grunt but didn't stop. This guy was relentless. I bolted, leaving my gear behind. The forest became a blur as I weaved between the trees. My heart pounded in my ears. I could hear him crashing through the underbrush behind me. Then I saw it. A small cabin up ahead. Smoke curled from the chimney. Salvation. I sprinted toward it, banging on the door as I reached the porch. "Help! Please, open up!" An elderly woman opened the door, eyes wide with surprise. "What's going on?" she asked. "Someone's trying to kill me." She hurried me inside and locked the door. The interior was cluttered but cozy, filled with trinkets and the smell of baking bread. "There's a phone over there," she said, pointing to an old rotary dial. I rushed to it, dialing the ranger station. No signal. Figures. "Do you have a weapon?" I asked. She nodded, pulling a shotgun from behind a cabinet. Just then, the windows shattered as the man burst through. Glass sprayed everywhere. The woman fired the shotgun, but he was too quick. He knocked it out of her hands and threw her to the ground. I grabbed a cast iron skillet from the stove and swung with all my might. It connected with his head, and he staggered but didn't go down. His gaze fixed on me, more animal than human. He tackled me, and we crashed into a shelf, sending books and ornaments flying. Pain shot through my shoulder. I struggled beneath his weight, his knife inching closer to my throat. Out of nowhere, Felix appeared in the doorway, gun drawn. "Get off him!" Felix shouted. The man hesitated for a split second. It was all I needed. I shoved him off and scrambled away. Felix fired a warning shot into the ceiling. "Last chance, pal," Felix warned. The man charged at Felix. Two shots rang out. The assailant collapsed to the floor, blood pooling around him. Breathing heavily, I looked at Felix. "How did you find me?" "Got a call about screams in the area," he said, eyes still on the motionless body. The elderly woman got up slowly, shaken but unharmed. "Thank you," I said to both of them. Felix radioed for backup, and within an hour, the place was swarming with law enforcement. They identified the attacker as a wanted criminal who'd been hiding in the woods for months. They also found evidence linking him to the missing campers. As the sun began to set, I retrieved my gear with Felix's help. The forest seemed different now, less inviting, more ominous. "Guess I owe you one," I told Felix. "Just doing my job," he replied with a faint smile. We parted ways at the park entrance. I loaded my equipment into my truck, ready to head home. My name is Daniel Rourke, and it was on August 12, 1995, deep in the forests of Montana, that everything changed. I've been a wildlife photographer for over a decade, drawn to the serenity of nature and the thrill of capturing rare moments. The wilderness felt like home, a place where I could be myself, away from the noise of the city. That summer, I was working on a project to document the elusive gray wolves recently reintroduced to the area. It was important work, and I was eager to contribute. My friend Marcus Hale, another photographer, joined me on this expedition. We'd met years ago at a gallery exhibit and bonded over our shared passion for nature and photography. Alongside us was Rachel Summers, a biologist assigned by the conservation agency to monitor the wolves. She was sharp, dedicated, and had an infectious enthusiasm for the project. We set up camp near a remote riverbank, miles from the nearest town. The first few days were uneventful, filled with hikes through dense forest and patient, waiting for a glimpse of the wolves. The air was crisp, the scent of pine ever present. At night, we'd sit by the campfire, sharing stories and planning our next moves. On the fourth day, things took a strange turn. We noticed the forest was unusually quiet. No birds singing, no rustling in the underbrush. "It's like everything's hiding," Rachel remarked. Marcus shrugged. "Maybe they know something we don't," he joked, but there was an unease that settled over us. That evening, as the sun dipped below the horizon, we heard a distant scream. It was faint, but unmistakably human. We exchanged glances. "Did you hear that?" I asked. Rachel nodded, her face pale. "We should check it out," Marcus suggested. We grabbed our flashlights and headed toward the sound. The forest grew denser, the trees closing in as darkness enveloped us. After about half an hour, we stumbled upon a campsite, or what was left of it. Tents were shredded, gear scattered, and the ground was stained dark. The metallic scent in the air confirmed our fears. "What happened here?" Rachel whispered. Marcus scanned the area with his flashlight. "This wasn't the work of any animal I've ever seen," he muttered. As we searched for survivors, we found no one, only signs of a violent struggle. Deep gouges marred the trees, too large to be from any known predator. My stomach churned. "We need to get back and call for help," I said. Before we could move, a heavy rustling came from the bushes behind us. We turned, flashlights trembling in our hands. A massive figure emerged from the shadows. It stood on all fours, yet its shoulders were level with my chest. Covered in matted fur, its body resembled a wolf but was grotesquely larger and more muscular. Its snout was elongated, filled with sharp teeth that glinted in the light. Rachel gasped. "What is that?" she stammered. The creature let out a deep roar, a sound that seemed to vibrate the very ground. "Run!" I shouted. We sprinted back the way we came, the creature crashing through the underbrush behind us. Branches whipped at our faces, the forest a blur of shadows and fear. Marcus was ahead, Rachel just behind me. The path was treacherous in the dark, and every step felt like a gamble. Suddenly, Rachel cried out and fell. I skidded to a halt, turning back to help her. The creature was gaining. "Go!" she urged, but I wasn't leaving her behind. I hoisted her up, and we pushed forward. The creature's heavy footsteps grew louder. Marcus shouted from ahead, "This way!" We burst into a small clearing where we'd left some of our equipment earlier. Marcus grabbed a flare gun from his pack. "Keep moving!" he yelled. He fired the flare directly at the creature. It struck its shoulder, igniting the fur. The beast roared in pain but didn't stop. It swiped at Marcus, claws tearing through his jacket. He stumbled back, blood seeping through the fabric. "Marcus!" Rachel screamed. I grabbed a fallen branch and swung at the creature, hitting it across the face. It barely flinched but turned its attention to me. "Get him out of here!" I shouted to Rachel. She helped Marcus to his feet, and they staggered toward the campsite. The creature lunged at me, and I dodged, narrowly avoiding its jaws. Desperate, I reached into my pocket and pulled out a pocket knife. Not much, but all I had. The beast circled me, its movements predatory and deliberate. My mind raced. I needed to slow it down. Spotting a canister of bear spray attached to my belt, I grabbed it and aimed. As the creature charged, I unleashed the spray directly into its face. It recoiled, shaking its head violently. Seizing the moment, I ran toward the campsite. My lungs burned and every muscle screamed, but I didn't stop until I reached the others. At the campsite, Rachel was bandaging Marcus's wounds. "We have to get to the truck," I said. "Now." Our vehicle was parked a short distance away, but between us and safety was the dark expanse of the forest. and the creature. We gathered what supplies we could, including a rifle Marcus had brought for protection. Moving cautiously, we headed toward the truck. The forest was unnervingly silent.
"Do you think it's gone?"
Rachel whispered. A sudden crash answered her question. The creature burst from the trees, fury in its movements. Marcus, despite his injuries, raised the rifle and fired. The shot hit the beast in the leg, causing it to stumble.
"Keep going!"
I shouted. We broke into a run. The truck was in sight, keys in my hand. Rachel helped Marcus into the back seat while I jumped into the driver's seat. The engine roared to life just as the creature slammed into the side of the vehicle, denting the metal. I floored the accelerator. The tires spun for a moment before gripping the dirt road. We sped away, the creature chasing us briefly before fading into the distance. We didn't stop until we reached the nearest town, bursting into the sheriff's office with our harrowing tale. At first, they were skeptical. Who wouldn't be? But the sight of Marcus's wounds and our sheer terror convinced them to investigate. A team was dispatched to the forest, and we insisted on guiding them back. Daylight was breaking as we arrived at the destroyed campsite. The creature was there, its massive body lifeless on the ground. The rifle shot had been more effective than we realized. The authorities examined the scene, their disbelief evident.
"What in the world is this?" one deputy muttered.
Biologists and wildlife experts were called in. The creature didn't match any known species. Its features were a disturbing blend of familiar animals. A wolf's body, but far larger, with claws and teeth that defied explanation. Nearby, they found evidence of the missing campers, personal belongings, torn clothing, and tragically, remains that confirmed our worst fears. The site became a flurry of activity as investigators combed through every detail. Over the next few days, the forest was closed off. News of the incident spread, though details were kept under wraps. We were interviewed extensively, our accounts scrutinized. The evidence was undeniable. Marcus recovered in the hospital, his wounds healing. Rachel and I stayed in town, cooperating with the investigation. The creature's body was taken to a research facility for further study. Scientists were baffled, theories ranging from genetic mutations to undiscovered species. In the aftermath, safety measures were increased in the area. Warnings were issued to hikers and campers. The incident sparked discussions about the mysteries that still lurk in the wild, reminding everyone of nature's unpredictability. Rachel, Marcus, and I met up once he was released from the hospital. Sitting together, we didn't need to say much. The experience had bonded us in a way few could understand. My name is Nolan Carpenter, and this happened to me in September 1998 in the Bitterroot National Forest. As a wildlife photographer, I'd spent years trekking through America's most remote landscapes, chasing the perfect shot. That month, I was deep in Montana, hoping to capture the elusive wolverine on film. I set up camp near a stream, the kind of spot where animals come to drink at dawn. The air was crisp, the pine trees whispering with the breeze. I had my Nikon loaded with fresh film rolls and a thermos of coffee to keep me warm through the chilly night. On the second day, I met Eliza Morton, a botanist cataloging rare plants. She was petite, with auburn hair tucked under a wide-brimmed hat. We shared a meal by the campfire, swapping stories about our encounters in the wild. She mentioned she'd seen unusual tracks nearby, unlike any animal she knew. "Could be a new species," she mused, poking the fire with a stick. "Or just a bear with an odd gait," I chuckled. But her eyes held a hint of concern. "Be careful out there, Nolan. Something feels off." That night, I couldn't shake her words. The forest was too quiet. No rustling of nocturnal creatures, no distant calls. Just silence. At dawn, I hiked toward the ridge where Eliza had spotted the tracks. The ground was damp, and sure enough, I found them. Impressions larger than a wolf's paw, with elongated toes ending in sharp indentations. I photographed them, curious. As I moved deeper into the woods, a foul smell hit me, like decay mixed with wet soil. Pushing through a thicket, I stumbled upon a scene that churned my stomach. a deer, or what was left of it, torn apart with a savagery I'd never witnessed. The ribs were exposed, organs missing, flesh shredded. I heard a snap behind me. Spinning around, I saw nothing but trees and shadows. The hairs on my neck stood up. I decided to head back. On the way, I crossed paths with Marcus Lyle, a seasoned hiker. Tall and rugged, he'd been exploring these woods for decades. "You're pale as a ghost, Nolan," he noted. "Found a deer that looked like it met a chainsaw," I said. He frowned. "I've heard whispers from the locals about something unnatural roaming these parts." We agreed to keep in touch and parted ways. Back at camp, I couldn't relax. Every rustle made me jump. By evening, Eliza hadn't returned to her tent pitched nearby. I waited, watching the sun dip below the horizon. Concern gnawed at me. Grabbing my flashlight and a flare gun, I decided to search for her. "Eliza!" I called out, my voice swallowed by the darkness. Following a narrow trail, I spotted her hat snagged on a branch. The fabric was torn, and there were traces of blood on the leaves. My pulse quickened. Further ahead, I found Marcus's backpack, contents strewn about. No sign of him either. A low rumbling noise echoed through the trees, a sound that resonated in my bones. Not a growl, but something deeper, more menacing. I moved cautiously, the flashlight beam cutting through the blackness. Then I saw it. A silhouette unlike any animal I'd known. It stood on four muscular limbs, its back arching like a big cat's, but larger, almost the size of a horse. Its fur was matted, patches missing to reveal scarred skin. In its jaws hung a torn piece of clothing, a shirt sleeve that looked eerily like the one Marcus had been wearing. The creature dropped it and fixed its gaze on me, though I couldn't see its eyes. My instincts screamed to run, but my legs felt anchored. It advanced slowly, muscles rippling under its hide. Desperate, I fired the flare gun. The flare shot past it, illuminating the creature briefly. Its face resembled a bear's snout but elongated, with teeth that protruded even when its mouth was closed. The sudden light startled it, giving me a split second to move. I sprinted back toward camp, adrenaline propelling me forward. Behind me, heavy footfalls indicated it was giving chase. Branches whipped my face, the terrain uneven. I tripped over a root, crashing hard. Pain shot through my ankle. Scrambling up, I saw the creature closing in. In a frantic move, I grabbed a fallen branch and swung as it leaped toward me. The wood connected with a sickening thud against its skull. It staggered but didn't fall. I reached into my pocket for anything and felt my pocket knife. As it lunged again, I sidestepped and slashed at its flank. The blade barely penetrated, but it was enough to make it recoil. Blood oozed from the wound, dark and thick. It circled me, more cautious now. I noticed a steep drop nearby, a ravine shrouded by undergrowth. An idea formed. I backed toward the edge, taunting the creature. It charged. At the last moment, I dove aside. Unable to stop, it plummeted over the ledge, a heavy crash followed by silence. Breathing hard, I peered over. The creature lay motionless on the rocks below, limbs twisted unnaturally. I hobbled back to camp, my ankle throbbing. With no sign of Eliza or Marcus, I knew I had to get help. I drove to the nearest ranger station, reporting everything. A search party was organized. They found the creature's body where it had fallen. Experts couldn't identify it. A mix of species, they said, unlike anything documented. They also found Marcus and Eliza. Both were gone. Authorities cordoned off the area. Questions were asked, reports filed. The forest was closed to the public pending investigation. In the aftermath, life continued. I was crouched in the underbrush, camera lens trained on a pair of fox kits playing in the distance, when I heard the first scream. It wasn't the kind of sound you could mistake. Raw, jagged, and unmistakably human. I froze, heart pounding. It was 2007, and I was deep in the remote stretches of the Olympic National Forest in Washington. My name is Lucas Rayburn, and I've spent most of my adult life capturing the beauty and brutality of wildlife. This wasn't my first time alone in the woods, but in hindsight, I should have never come out here alone. I'd been commissioned to photograph some of the more elusive fauna in this area, a potential career maker after years of working local gigs. I'd heard the stories, of course, Everyone in the wildlife photography circuit had. People went missing out here more than they should have, but I figured I'd be fine. I was always careful. I carried a GPS, a satellite phone, and a decent understanding of survival skills. What I didn't carry was a gun, partly because of regulations, partly because I didn't think I'd ever need one. That day, I regretted that decision more than any other. The scream echoed again, this time closer. My first instinct was to head in the opposite direction, but curiosity overruled fear. I told myself someone could be in real trouble. Maybe a hiker had fallen or been attacked by an animal. I slung my camera over my shoulder, tucked my tripod under my arm, and started moving toward the sound. The terrain was rugged, each step a calculated decision between ankle-breaking roots and treacherous moss-covered rocks. As I moved deeper into the forest, the air grew colder, denser, like the trees were conspiring to lock me in. The scream came again, and this time it was cut off abruptly, as though someone had clamped a hand over the person's mouth. Or worse. I found a clearing about a quarter mile in. At first it looked unremarkable, just a scatter of logs and rocks surrounded by towering firs. But then I noticed the signs. The grass was matted down in wide swaths, as if something heavy had been dragged. There were scraps of fabric caught on low branches, and what I thought was mud at first glance was far too dark and viscous. I knelt to inspect it, and nearly gagged when the metallic tang hit my nose. Blood. The scream had stopped, but something else had replaced it. A strange clicking noise, rhythmic and deliberate, like the sound of nails tapping on a wooden surface. It was coming from just beyond the clearing, where the trees were unnaturally dense, their trunks twisted and gnarled like arthritic fingers. I hesitated, weighing my options. Common sense told me to leave, but some stubborn part of me, maybe the part that had kept me in this line of work, pushed me forward. The first thing I saw was a shoe, half buried in the underbrush. It was a hiking boot, the kind you'd find at any outdoor supply store, but the laces were frayed, and the leather was soaked through with something dark. Then I saw the body, or rather, what was left of it. It was a man, mid-30s if I had to guess, though it was hard to tell with his face. Missing. His torso had been flayed open, ribs gleaming like the keys of a broken piano. I stumbled back, bile rising in my throat. My foot caught on something, and I went sprawling. When I looked down, I saw what had tripped me. A severed hand, its fingers curled in a grotesque mimicry of life. The clicking noise grew louder, sharper, and now it was accompanied by a low, guttural breathing. I turned toward the sound and saw it. At first, my brain refused to process what I was looking at. It was roughly humanoid, but its proportions were all wrong. Its arms were too long, ending in clawed hands that scraped against the ground as it moved. Its skin was mottled and leathery, stretched taut over protruding bones. And its face, God, its face, was a nightmare of asymmetry, with a mouth too wide and teeth like shards of broken glass. It moved with an unnatural fluidity, its head tilting back and forth like a predator sizing up its prey. It saw me. I ran. I'd like to think I'm fast, but adrenaline does funny things to your body. My legs felt like lead, my breaths coming in ragged gasps as I tore through the forest. The creature didn't roar or howl. It just pursued me with an eerie silence, the only sound the rhythmic tapping of its claws against the ground. I zigzagged, hoping to throw it off, but every time I glanced over my shoulder, it was there, closing the distance. I burst into another clearing and spotted a tree with low-hanging branches. Desperation took over and I scrambled up, my hands slipping on the damp bark. I climbed as high as I dared and pressed my back against the trunk, trying to steady my breathing. The creature entered the clearing moments later, its movement slower now, almost curious. It sniffed the air, its elongated neck craning upward. For a moment I thought it would climb after me, but then it did something worse. It began to mimic. At first, it was just the scream I'd heard earlier, perfectly replicated down to the raw desperation. Then came other sounds, a man's voice shouting for help, a child's laughter, even the rustling of leaves. It was like a warped symphony, each note designed to unnerve and disorient. I clamped my hands over my ears.
but the sounds burrowed into my brain, relentless and mocking. Hours passed, or maybe it was minutes. Time had no meaning in that place. The creature eventually wandered off, but I knew better than to climb down. I stayed in the tree until the sky began to lighten, my muscles cramped and my stomach churning with hunger and fear. When I finally descended, the forest was eerily quiet. I made my way back to my campsite, praying the creature had lost interest. My gear was untouched, but my tent had been slashed to ribbons, and the remnants of my food were scattered across the ground. It had been here, taunting me. I packed up as quickly as I could and started the long hike back to my truck. Every snap of a twig, every rustle of leaves made my heart leap into my throat. I half expected the creature to appear again, to finish what it had started, but the forest remained still. When I reached the trailhead, I found another hiker, a middle-aged woman with a bright orange backpack. I tried to warn her, to tell her to turn back, but she brushed me off with a polite laugh. I didn't stick around to argue. I just got in my truck and drove, the memory of that flayed body and those mocking sounds seared into my mind. I later learned that the woman never made it out of the forest. Search and rescue found her backpack shredded, her camera smashed, and enough blood to confirm she hadn't survived. They never found her body. Sometimes I think about going back, not to confront the creature, but to document it, to prove it exists. But then I remember the way it mimicked those voices, the way it seemed to enjoy the chase, and I decide it's better to let the forest keep its secrets. As for the creature, I've done some research, pieced together local legends and accounts. They call it the mocker, a thing born of the woods, a predator that doesn't just hunt but plays with its prey. And while I may have escaped with my life, I know I'll never really be free of it. The mocker is out there somewhere waiting for its next game.